Gary and Austin were in middle school, I think maybe they were doghouse. But they took a child to bring peace to the family.
Thank you. sit back here thinking that we have come to a close of another year. And the tendency is to look back and reflect on the past year. And I have thought about the church when we reflect back on this past year in the history of our church. I think we could say it may have been one of the best years in the history of this church. We've had numerous people saved and baptized. There have been a large number of people who have joined our fellowship this year. The Lord has certainly blessed us in a spiritual way. We are blessed with the pastor and the associate pastor that we have. I can't imagine anybody having anyone any better. And he has certainly blessed our church financially in a way that we've never been blessed before in the history of this church. So when we look back on this past year for our church, certainly we ought to be thankful and praise God and thank Him for all the goodness that He has given to us. And even in our personal lives, and there are going to be adversities. Job was a man who was a man of integrity. He loved the Lord, but he still had adversities in his life. And we will have adversities in our lives as long as we live. But if we know the Lord and know what the future holds, Alice and I was talking to a lady today, and her husband and I are good friends, and John is 83. Kate said, "One thing about it, Floyd, we're a day closer to heaven." And can't we all say amen to that?
Amen.
Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the privilege you've given us to be back in your house again tonight. And as I've said, we thank you for all the many blessings you have bestowed upon our church, upon our membership, in our individual lives. Truly, we are a people blessed. Father, I pray for our nation tonight. Our nation seems to be drifting away from you. But even with that, you have blessed us beyond measure as a nation. We are still the greatest nation on this earth. And we thank you for that. We pray for our leaders tonight. We pray that they would have a desire to seek seek your wisdom, seek your guidance in decisions that have to be made, as in our individual lives, we do the same thing. We seek guidance and wisdom from you. And then, Father, we bring to you tonight the many names that are on our prayer concerns list. If we started to name them, I couldn't name them all. But there are many, with many needs. But Father, we serve a living God who can meet every need in our lives. And Father, we just pray that for those who may be in the hospital, those who are in nursing homes, there are those who are at home and aren't able to get out. Father, we pray that you'd bring healing in their lives if it be your will, because we all realize that it's your will that must be done. Where death has come to families this year, Father, and we have had many of those in our congregation this year, pray that you give strength, encourage in a way that only you can. Father, we pray that you'll be in our worship service tonight, be with Brother Jack as he brings the message. We thank you for him. We thank you for his life. We thank you for his leadership. We thank you for the love that he has, not only for the Lord, but for this congregation. And Father, we pray for our worship service Sunday morning. Father, we thank you for our pastor Nathan. We're so thankful that you sent him this way to a congregation at a time who was in need. And just as you meet needs in our individual lives, you met a need in the life of this congregation. And we pray that you bless him, bless Don and the girls. We pray that you would be with our youth as they're away this week. Give them a good time, a safe trip. Be at our worship service this Sunday morning. Be with the pastor as he brings a message. Be with Brother Grady as he leads in music. Be with the one who will have deacon devotion. Anyone who has a part in our service Sunday morning, may everything that is said and done be for the uplifting and the glorifying of your name. For we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Brother Ford, but I want to tell you, you made me nervous. I thought for a minute, I mean, it's a chance I might have to go back there and change the lock on the door to my office. If you have your Bibles, turn with me tonight to James chapter 5 and verse 13. James chapter 5, verse 13. You understand just a moment why I said that made it a moment. James chapter 5, again verse 13. Go to now, ye that say, today or tomorrow we will go into this city, and continue there a year, and buy and sell and get gain. Whereas ye know not what shall be on the morrow. But what is your life? Is even a vapor it appears for a little time, and then vanishes away? Or that ye ought to say, if the Lord will, we shall live and do this or that. But now you rejoice in your boasting, all such rejoicing is evil. Therefore, to him that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him in his sin. I can speak to you for a few moments tonight on the subject, the hands that hold tomorrow. The hands that hold tomorrow. I too began to reflect on this past year. I'm sure for some of you sitting here, it's been a great year. For some of you sitting here, this past year has probably not been a very good year. For some sitting here, it may just have been another year. But when we think about this year, what has it brought in my life? What's it brought in your life? Florida City, I brought a tremendous blessing to our church family. A lot of good things have really happened this year. But when we think about 2015, this is the last scheduled service in this church on this year. After tonight, unless God breaks otherwise or something happens, there'll be no more services in this church in 2015. Think about it. This year is coming. In just a few hours, we'll be celebrating the new year, 2016. I have no idea what 2016 will bring. But I know whose hands 2016 leads. It's God's. And I have no fear tonight of what 2016 is going to bring because I'm God's hand. The years are God's hand. Today, I heard on the news, just briefly, that in Europe they had fallen at least three posts by ISIS to do their dastardly deeds on New Year's Day. New Year's Eve. Today I heard for the first time, maybe you've heard of it before, that Iran had fired off a missile in about 15,000 yards of one of our battleships in the Persian Gulf. Iran specs in the muscle because they perceive us as being weak. I don't know what the future holds with that situation in the Middle East, but I know whose hands holds the future. We're concerned tonight about many things. And it seems the more I visit Christians, non-Christians, people out in the world, the more I visit, the more people talk to me about things that they are concerned about. And it seems to me that there's an anxiety that's building with people, particularly non-Christians, about what the future holds. What might happen? Will 2016 bring a terrorist attack on the United States? I don't know. Given the propensity of terrorism in the past year, probably so. But I don't know that. Will there be an economic collapse in 2016? I don't know that. Will there be some other natural disaster take place in 2016? I don't know that. I can't predict the future. But I know the one that holds the future tonight. And I don't have to be worried. You don't have to be worried about what the future holds because we are in His hands. Amen. Tonight, I'm not preaching to the choir because you're the backbone of the church. You're the spiritual group of the church because you're here service after service after service. You're praying. You uphold the church. I mean, you all are a good group of people, and I thank the Lord for you. I don't want you to go away tonight being discouraged. I want you to go away tonight being encouraged. Because, again, tonight, I want to talk to you about being encouraged because we know the one that holds the future. I dare say that every person here tonight is saved of the Lord Jesus Christ, the first Savior. If you don't, I pray that you be saved before you leave tonight. But we know the Lord Jesus Christ is our personal Savior. We're confident in the fact that He's caring for us and cares for us. But here in these verses of Scripture, James writes about three groups of people that we can see in the Bible. Three different groups. And as we go through these three groups, we talk about the will of God in this a little bit, but mostly about our country. I wish to take note. In what category do you think, and I'm going to leave it up to you, I know where I place America, but I want you to think about what group does America belong in tonight? America was founded on God's principles and on the Holy Bible. Our founding documents were written by godly men, most of them. Most of the signers of the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution, all of the documents, most of them were Christians. Most of them sacrificed a lot to put their name, affix their name to their doctrines. So godly men and women were founders of this country. We founded it upon the principle of God. But I want you to know that tonight, in light of where our world is tonight, I believe there's no denying that our world is not in good shape as it was at the founding of our country. I believe only a person that's like an ostrich sticks their head in sand, by the way, don't do it, it's an old cliche, sticks their head in sand and denies reality can say that America is better off today than it was a few years ago. I've been in ministry for almost 39 years now. In just a few months, it'll be 39 years. I never thought that I'd ever see some of the things happening in our country. Something being done in our country is being done today. And I stand in awe sometimes, not surprised, but I stand in awe sometimes at the things that are being done in our country. But remember, God's hands are holding our hands. Repeat that. God's hands has the hold of our hands, and we can be secure now. We can be confident about what the future holds. The first thing I want to look at tonight is the objection to God's will. Look at verse 13 again, please. Go to now, you that say, today or tomorrow we will go into such a city and continue there a year and buy and sell and get gain. James apparently was writing to the assembly, the church. And in church, James apparently saw merchants sitting in the church. And perhaps they were even discussing their deals and what they want to do in the coming years and the coming days. They were discussing these trades and these transactions they want to do in the coming days. And apparently from what is written here, they were taking no regard to what the future held and who held the future. They apparently were taking no regard to what God's will was in their lives. So James writes, actually says, go to you and say, today or tomorrow we'll go into such a city and continue our year and buy and sell and get gain. When we look at this, there was a decision being made and God was being left out. There was the seeds about what they were going to do in the future, what they hope to gain in the future, and God will do that matters. When we think about America tonight, many would say America is at a crossroads. I don't know where America is in terms of God's history or timeline. But I speak to you tonight that in the past, we're not going to rehash the past few months what all happened. But I speak to you tonight, America has already passed the crossroads. And America has embarked on the wrong road. I believe tonight America is going down a road that leads to destruction. I believe America tonight is on the wrong road that leads many people to hell. Now, why did I say that? When I see all the things going on in this country, and listen, I love this country. God gave us this country. I believe God ordained this country to be. I believe many good things have come because of this country. One thing that I believe tonight, because of America, Israel is in existence. I believe that Israel is in existence because of America. Because America has stood with Israel since 1948. America has protected Israel. America has been on Israel's side. But today, our political system is going against Israel. For many years, and many presidents, Democrats and Republicans, both alike, have tried to force Israel to give land for peace. They tried to force Israel into a peace accord that was not good for Israel, not God that ordained. But yet, America, for the most part, has stood with Israel. Today, we see even many preachers preaching replacement theology, replacing saying that God hates the Jews, that God despises the Jews, so far and forth. God hates the Jews and despises them. We should despise them and hate them. But that is contrary to what the Word of God says. So I believe one of the reasons that Americans exist today is because we have supported and stood by Israel, God's chosen people. But when we look at the path and this road that America is taking today, where are we at today? You make the decision. Remember, God's hands hold tomorrow. And I want to say more apart from this thought, that the Arabs and the devil and the ISIS and all the other will never defeat God. They will never overcome Israel because God's hand is on Israel and God is protecting Israel. Exercise of futility. But they don't understand it. And apparently many of our people today in leadership don't understand. Look at verse 14, the first portion. Whereas you know not what shall be on the morrow, for what is your life? Again, I'm no prophet. I can't see you tomorrow. I don't know what will happen after church and I start tomorrow. Much less what's going to be next year. Neither do you. It's good that we make plans. It's good we try to plan for the future. I tell you tonight on the way home because the gas light came on the car and we stopped and get some gasoline. Or else I'll be calling like Nathan did, okay? But I'm going to make some plans. I'm going to have some plans. My wife will stop at the grocery store and get some food to feed us for the next few days. We have to make some plans. But my friend, listen. When we make those plans, we need to consider what God's will is for our lives. And America, as she begins to make plans in the future, needs to consider what God's will is for America. As Freud said, I believe America is one of the greatest nations, not the greatest nation ever been upon the face of the earth. And I praise God for this country. In Proverbs chapter 27, verse 1, it says, boast not thyself tomorrow, for thou shalt knowest not what a day may bring forth. We live in a country where there's a lot of boasting of what we're going to do. The political season is on. And all kinds of promises are being made by Democrats and Republicans. All kinds of things they said, knowing very well that they can't do these things. That they're trying to get votes, trying to win your support. My friend, I wonder about these candidates. And they go out and they make these boasts and they talk about tomorrow. Have they ever considered the will of God and what God's will is for our country and where America is today? W.A. Criswell, the pastor at one time of the largest Baptist church in America in Dallas, Texas, told a story of a teenager he was talking to one day. He witnessed this teenager. The teenager said, "Pastor Criswell, I would give my heart to God and I would live for him. I would serve him, but I'm afraid that he'll send me to a place of danger." Preacher Criswell loved the young man and said, "Listen, the danger is not where God will send you. The danger is in rejecting God's will for your life." Beloved, we look sometimes to the future. We look out there in time and space. And we consider God may take us and pass us somewhere that is not very pleasant. God may take us from home and pass us somewhere on a mission field. God may take us and place us in a difficult situation. Yes, that may happen. But remember, whose hands are holding our hands? Who's in control of tomorrow? You see, thousands of years ago, millions of years ago, God was already in tomorrow. God was already preparing tomorrow for me before I was even born. God knew, God knows what's coming my way, and God's already there, and God preparing for me in tomorrow. And for you, and if our country would let God be in charge, God would already be preparing for our country. So the first group here that James talked to was those who attended to God's will. Is America at a place where we are objecting or rejecting, maybe I should say, God's will? He's right. Secondly, there's a group there that had an obligation to God's will. Now I have to explain a little bit to you. Look at verse 17, please. "Therefore, to him that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it is sin." What talk about objecting to God's sin? Well, Jesus said in Luke chapter 19, verse 10, "For the Son of Man is come to seek and save that which was lost." That's you, that's me. There's a time when I realized I was out of hope. Because I was born in sin, I was shaped in sin, the Bible says. Because Jesus Christ was not my Savior, I was destined to hell. But God, according to John 3:16, loved us so much that he sent his Son to die on the cross of Calvary for our sins, who might go to heaven. So you see, because he purchased me with a price, because he gave his blood for me, he paid my sin debt, a debt that I owed, and he paid and didn't know that he paid it. Because of that, I'm obligated to do the Father's will. You're obligated to do God's will because he saved you. We have an obligation to do God's will. But again, we're talking about America. I'm not preaching to you because you're saved. I think y'all are trying to mention to God's will. I'm not preaching to you, but I wonder what you think of it. America has an obligation because I think God was in the forming of this nation. There are too many where America took place during the Revolutionary War. There are too many things that took place that cannot be explained except by the mercy of God. There was a time, and I shared this with the VBS class a couple years ago. There was a time when George Washington was riding through the battlefield. A British sniper had sights on George Washington, but he would not fire because George Washington was an officer. Now think about that. The enemy sniper had his sights set up on George Washington, he did not fire. Beloved, God's hand was a decision not to fire. You see, George Washington was a primary principal mover in the forming of this country. He was a leader that led our armies to victory during the Revolutionary War. There are many miracles in the city form, and there are many miracles that cannot be explained except God's hand was upon the men and women that formed this country and upon the form of this country. So America had a duty and obligation to an almighty God who brought this country into existence. But let me talk to you about the obligation. In the book of Jonah, y'all familiar with the book of Jonah, in chapter 1, God speaks to Jonah and tells Jonah what he wants to do. He comes and talks to Jonah and says, Jonah wants to go down to Nineveh and preach. But what did this backslidden preacher do? He began to run from God. He went down and booked ship going in the opposite direction. In chapter 2, we see a storm came along. The sailors threw an overboard and a fish. And I believe a fish, because the Bible said a fish swallowed. A fish prepared by God to swallow this backslidden preacher. I believe it had a stomachache for 3 days. But this fish took Jonah and brought him up on the shore. But what happened in the belly of this fish? This preacher began to pray. He began to cry and began to plead with God. And God spared him. For God had a job for Jonah to go to Nineveh. In chapter 3, we see Jonah going to Nineveh and preaching the word. The Ninevites heard, they listened, they responded, they got saved, they turned their nation around because they listened to the preaching of the word. But how many years now have the pulpits across America been crying and pleading with people to turn around, repent, to turn back to God? How many years now have we heard the same message I've heard all my life from 7 years ago? I heard the same message. We need to repent and turn to God and come and heal our land. As God's formula said down in the, we'll talk about that in just a little while, but God's formula, which is to repent, turn to God. But the Ninevites listened, they heard, they listened. But turn to chapter 4, Jonah, we see something else. Here is a preacher that ran from God. God intervened. God brought him to Nineveh. God gave him a second chance. And what does he do? He goes out and sits down on the hillside under a gourd bound to God your clay. And there this preacher begins to pout. Why? Because God spared the Ninevites. Because God worked, because God did not destroy as John was saying he's going to. He began to act. You see, here is a preacher and a preach the message, but his heart's not in it. I wonder when we think about John tonight, is God displeased with America? Is God looking on America like he looked on Jonah as he began to run and disobey God? Yes, Jonah went and fulfilled his obligation because he was afraid God would punish him again, that God would spank him again. But how many times in the past few years has America been spanked through the natural disaster we had, through the 9/11, through all the other things we can name tonight, where God has chastised, I believe with all my heart, God has chastised America, but have we learned anything from this? So you think about that. Is God displeased with America? Back to Jonah. Here's a man that put these sailors' life in peril because he wouldn't listen to God. Think about it. The ship could have been lost, these sailors could have perished because this man was living with God. Jonah had actually sat down there on the hillside and pouted because the Ninevites weren't destroyed, because his gourd weren't destroyed, his vine. He pouted because he thought he was these things. Jonah, this plague here, a don't care attitude, Linda knows. What about America? Does America care about my registry, about your registries? Are we so politically correct today that we have to embrace all the other religions and call them, that we can't embrace the Judeo-Christian ethics and standards we have today as Christians? I'm afraid today that many times a Christian liberties are thrown under the bus in favor of other religions.
So that's what I'm talking about in the obligation to the will of God.
Then there's a third group of speakers out here. Those that are obedient to the will of God. Look at verse 15. Well, that is to say, I would say, if the Lord will, we shall live and do this or that. Obedience. The Bible says obedience is better than sacrifice. We're God's children. He has the right. He has the privilege to speak to us and expect us to respond. If God wills something, it's good, it's right. God's not going to do anything in my life or your life which is bad for you. Romans 8:28 is hard to swallow sometimes, as the pastor talked about on that Sunday. But listen, everything that happens in my life has a reason. God does not allow things to come in my life without a reason. You see, I'm God's child, I'm in His hands tonight. Sometimes adversity comes. God can use that adversity to make you a better person. Not a better person. Many times people get better because of adversity. But God can use it to make you a better person. God can use adversity to make our country a better country. We're God's hands. He's in tomorrow already. In Psalms chapter 9, verse 17 says, the wicked shall be turned into hell, and all the nations will forget God. Think about it now. Is that where America's at tonight? Have we forgotten God? Just here in Carter County, Elizabeth, how many churches do we have? Man, I wouldn't venture a guess. But dozens. Well, look around tonight. Where are the people? Where are the people? And we're in the Bible Belt. We're in the cradle of the Bible Belt. And if it's that bad here, think about the big cities like San Francisco, Atlanta, where sin is running rampant in the streets. Think about it. It's bad here, how people care so little about God's house and what God's will, and care so little about their country. Think how bad it is here. Think how bad it must be in those big cities where they're rioting and burning down and trying to call policemen pigs in a blanket and we ought to roast them. No respect for our country, for those who have actually called to serve. But we're in God's hands tonight. God's holding my hand. God's holding your hand as His child. The Bible said we're His children. We're heirs, joint heirs with Jesus Christ. We are adopted children in the family of God by the reason of the blood of Christ. He cares for the Bible requires. He's holding your hand. Will there ever come a wake-up call in America? I don't know. I would like to think, yes. I would like to think there will be a time when America will fall on our knees and repent. And before we get a second on 7:14, so we can come back to that. I would like to think there will be a time when we see our country turn around. But I just don't know. In the back of my mind, I've got doubts and reservations. Again, talking to many people, talking to Christian, non-Christian, they're apprehension today. I don't know why people are so tense today, why they're so apprehensive today. I don't understand it. May 2016, God will come and rapture the church, and the Lord Jesus Christ will come on God of course and take us out of here. That'd be all right with me. Praise God. I'd like to see it. But I don't know that. No one does. I don't know what New Year's Day will bring. I know God's already there. Now He knows. He's holding my hand. 1 Thessalonians 5:17, I put this all the time to pray without ceasing. I brought you all the way from there to here for one reason. Folks, we are the only ones that we can count on each other. You hear me? You, my brothers and sisters in Christ, are the only ones I can really count on each other. The devil hates me. The world despises me. And the flesh wants to destroy me. But I count on you because you're my brothers and sisters in Christ. In 2016, we need to really be on our knees praying and pleading for God for our brothers and sisters in Christ. We need to pray that God put a hesitation on them, that God watch over the kingdom, and He will, because He's promised it. But also, we need to pray for the lost. I was sharing with Christ. A couple Sunday ago, we're talking about soul. You know, outside of the church, in this year of 2015, I found two people who were telling me they were lost like a living world. And folks, that's a shame. Now, believe me, I've reached, I've tried, I've talked to people, I've been at home, I've been there. But outside the church, two people is all that had prayers leading the Lord. So many say, yeah, I'm all right. Yeah, I'm saved. But they're actually in deeds. And I'm not judging, they're actually in deeds. I was saying, but the fruit should show they're actually in deeds, telling the other ones. We need to be so winning, we need to pray for one another, we need to do what we can. What kind of crisis you got to go through it, what kind of crisis I got to go through it, but I'm God's hands. You're God's hands. And I'm confident that God will see through. So we need your hands in 2016 in prayer. For one another. In prayer for the lost. In prayer for our country. In a time to make a difference in our country. I don't know. Is America gone? I don't know. Has God turned His back on her? I don't know. But I'm fearful tonight. It's our little apprehension in my heart tonight for America. But I want to tell you something. A few years ago, I received a phone call from Pastor Friend. He asked me to do a funeral. A funeral for an infant child that I'll live for a few years. At the graveyard at the summer time, it was a hard time for mom and daddy to only have just a few moments with that child. Another time the phone rang. Mom and dad asked me to have a funeral for a 7-year-old who died for 65 years. That mom and dad devastated. They were torn apart. Another time, the phone rang, an 18-year-old had died of lupus after 11 years. Their family was torn apart. But you know what God will do? Those hands already future. The hand of God was upon this family. Was it hard? Yes. Did it say yes? Did it crush your heart? Yes. Did it break them? Yes. But they turned to Almighty God and with his help. And those hands holding firm to their hands. God brought them through. Consider now Abraham. Abraham was faithful to God. He was counted him righteous. Abraham suffered a lot in his life. He stayed faithful to God and become the father of a great nation. Stay faithful to God in 16. Hold his hand because you've already got the victory. Now may come a verse in your life that you've got the victory now because God's holding your hand. Now may come a time when sickness comes, you've got the victory. God's holding your hand. Now may come a time of financial crisis, but God's holding your hand tonight. That may come time of some other thing in your life, but God is holding your hand tonight. And God is already in the future preparing for whatever is in you. God, whenever you say, let's marry him. Father, this year, God, Father, 2016 is here. Oh, we don't know what 2016 holds. Have no idea what is out there in the future. But Father, you do. And Father, we can have faith, we can have confidence, we can be assured tonight that no matter what besets us, Father, whatever comes our way, whether it be good or whether it be bad, we're the victors because you're holding our hand. Father, we can keep on keeping on because you're holding. And Father, if these people don't remember one thing tonight about what I've said, may they remember this. You're holding their hand no matter what. Father, I pray your blessed be upon my church, upon my church family in 2016. Father, we pray, Lord, if there be a 2016 that you take us and use us to your honor and your glory, I pray, Father, this year, this coming year, Father, that First Real Way Church of Elizabeth, Tennessee, to do great and mighty things for you. Not Lord, they would glory in themselves, but with glory in the fact that Jesus' name has been lifted up and sold and been saved. Now, Father, create in your hands where it is rightfully to be. In Jesus' name.